Okay, so good afternoon to everybody. Thank you for staying at the conference until the very end. So thank you very much. Today I will want to talk to you about, try to understand how Drupal builds your pages by looking internally at what it does. I'm Luca from Italy. I work for a Drupal company that it's called Sparfabric, that is based in Milan, in Italy, but we are a distributed company, sorry. I contribute a couple of modules for Drupal until Drupal 6, probably. The main one are Web Profiler, Monologue, and one of the latest one that is Symfony Messenger, the integration of Symfony Messenger component into Drupal. If you want to contact me, I'm LussoLuca everywhere, so it's easy. Okay, just a couple of time on this slide. Sparfabric is a tech company. We are engineers, developers, and designers. Our main topics are cloud native deployments, Drupal development, and native development, so React and Angular and so on. And we are committed to open source. We work a lot, we work only with open source tools and technologies. So we are here to contribute something to you. Okay, so basically, let's start. You may know that all pages in Drupal are built in the same way, okay? So someone send you a request and the response is produced and returned to the browser. Everything in Drupal follow exactly the same pattern. So in this session, I'll try to explain you how Drupal turns an HTTP request to an HTML response, basically. Okay. Maybe it's magic, but okay, so let's say we receive this GET HTTP request for a path in our Drupal website. Some magic happens, and then we receive some response back. How this is possible? Okay. In this presentation, we are using this example. This is a custom module I wrote just for this presentation. You cannot find it anywhere, but if you want, I can commit it somewhere if you want to try it. It's the most useful module in the world because it displays weather information. This module provides a custom page. This is not the output of a node provided by the node system of Drupal. This is because the node system is too complex to be analyzed in this short time, so I create a custom entity that it's called city, okay? This custom entity is used to store the description of the city, some geographic coordinates, and on this page we retrieve the city. We call some external services to collect weather and forecast information, then we build the output of this page. So we are looking how this page is built from Drupal. Okay, so why we have to understand how Drupal builds pages in so much details? Maybe it's not necessary. You can do your work probably without understanding everything. Maybe if you are a front-end developer or a site builder, why? It's not a problem at all if you don't. but if you are curious enough to go down to the rabbit hole, I try to explain how many levels your request cross before the response is created. So we get to take the red pill. Okay, the point here is that we want to discover what Drupal does without looking at it from the code side. We don't want to set up Xdebug, go step by step to understand, because there is a lot of code, a lot of layers. So we try to instrument our Drupal installation to see to retrieve those information from the outside, basically. Instrumentation is a typically concept of engineering in the context of computer programming. We want to measure performance and information from a system from the outside, basically. Instrumentation is typically done on three levels. We can profiling a website, tracing what the website does, or analyze logging. Okay, in this session we will concentrate on the first two points. So we are profiling our Drupal website and we are tracing our Drupal website. Okay, first of all, because we are trying to analyze the system, probably we want to disable of the optimization that Drupal has out of the box, so we can maybe reload the same page without receiving the response from some cache system, and this speed up our inspections. Hopefully, from Drupal 10.1, this is quite simple, so you can go to the web UI of Drupal, to this admin / config / development / settings page, and disable cache for the markup, enable Twig Debug, disable the Twig Cache, and so on. So you can do that to speed up the analysis. Then you have to turn them on when you are in production. Okay, starting from the profiling part, we will use a module, one of the modules that I maintain, that is called Web Profiler. It is at the beginning it was a straight part of the web debug component from Symfony. So if you ever use Symfony, every time when you are on the development environment on Symfony, you have a toolbar at the bottom of every page with some information. 14 years ago, I started a project by porting this module to Drupal, the component to Drupal as a module. And we will use this module to understand something. It depends on the devel module and on a module that also I contributed that is called Tracer, because as we saw later, some information that are useful for Web Profiler are also useful for other external systems that can be used to trace information, trace what happens on a Drupal site. You can download it, it's a module, and I have a short video about it. So I have installed it. If you require it with Composer and then you install it, you will have this toolbar at the end of every HTML pages with some widgets on it. Then let's see if this works. Okay. So there are a lot of widgets on the bottom. There are a link at the right end where you can go and configure Web Profiler itself. There are some configuration and a list of the active toolbar items that is shown on the toolbar. You can enable, disable what you need. In this case, we are enabled someone to collect information about front-end, HTTP request, routing services, the theme layer, translation. When you saw the configuration, the toolbar now has some widget more. you can see information about requests, about time, memory, database queries, services, assets, JS and CSS, events, forms, external HTTP calls, performance on the front end, the team, routing, and translation, and so on. If you click on one of those widgets, you go to the dashboard where all the information is shown. So here here you will find all the information the module collects about the request, the database queries. Probably I click on everyone, so on services, assets, so you see CSS, JavaScript libraries, Drupal settings, events, forms, and so on. Front-end performance, team information, routing information, and translations. Okay. Okay, on the reports page, we list all the profile we have collected for every pages you visited. So you can go there and see for every page that you visited in the past, you can go to the profile of that page. Okay. So everything in Drupal starts with this unique file. So this is the only file that Drupal exposes to the outside, basically. It's the index.php that is in the route of your Drupal installation. And what it does, it requires the Composer autoload file to load all the information from vendor or modules that expose classes or objects. Then it creates a new Drupal kernel. It handles the request, build the response, return the response, and then it terminates. This is what it's called a front controller pattern. It is quite typical in web application. So this is Drupal, basically. All the magic happens when the request is turned into a response, basically. Okay. So there is another concept that is implemented in the core of Drupal that comes from a project that is not Drupal. It is stackphp.com. And this is used to decorate the kernel, the Drupal kernel, when the response is converted in the response. It's decorated by a set of middlewares that they are used to add cache information. It's used to negotiate if the response should be HTML or AJAX or whatever. So the request cross a set of layers, then it will be handled by the Drupal kernel that converts it in a response. Then the response cross all the layers back in the opposite order, and the response is returned. Okay, we can use Web Profiler, for example, to list all the middlewares that the request cross before reaching the Drupal kernel. All the layers have a priority. So first of all, Drupal negotiates the type of response, if it's HTML, for example. Then there are a couple of middleware that the tracer and web profiler modules add to do something. And then there are some middlewares that deals with caching. The latest one starts the user session, and then the request is handled. Okay. So after the request crossed all the middlewares, it is handled by a router that will find the correct code to generate the response, take the request and generate the response. We can use again Web Profiler to see which which code has been used. In this case, it's a controller. Basically, 99% of the time, a response is built by a controller in Drupal. In this case, the controller is called forecast controller that has a method that is called page. If you configure the web profiler accordingly, if you click on the name of the controller, you will be redirected to your ID at the line in the file and at the line where the method is, so you can inspect the code directly. We will see this in a later slide. Okay, one other information that you can find using Web Profiler is the name of the route that has matched. The route system in Drupal is used to match a URL that comes from a request to a specific controller that will handle the and generate the response. Every route in Drupal has a name. So in this case, the name of the route is weather.forecast. So we can go to our code base and find and try to look where this route is defined. And we will find it in a file called weather.routing.yaml, where weather is the machine name of the module that contains this route. Here we will find the definition of the weather.forecast route. We will see that the path for this route is /forecast/curly-brace-city. And then some default information, some requirements, and some options. The important part here are the default parts and the option that we'll see in a moment. Before this, the web profiler also lists all routes that are present on your system. We can use it to check if this route this route exists. In effect, there are. So the weather.forecast, the path, and the controller that handle this route. Okay. Let's start with the option part of the route definition that it's used to convert the parameter that you receive from the URL to something that Drupal can manage. Okay, if you think at the node system, when you go to /node/27, okay, Drupal will not receive, the controller that will handle that page will not receive 27. It will receive the node object that Drupal has loaded from the database that has 27 as node ID. Okay, this is called, Drupal called this parameter converter or parameter upcaster, and it used to convert part of the URL to something more useful for the system. In this case, an instance of the city entity that I defined for this module. Okay. Again, if you look at your code and try to find something called weather column city, you will find this class somewhere, again in the weather module, but that has two methods. One is called applies, that you use to check if this route match and the parameter converter and can be used to upcast the parameter. And then the important part is the convert method that takes the value from the URL in the curly brace city part, that in our case is lil, and it uses it to retrieve the entity from the database, basically. So it loads the entity type manager, service, load the storage for the city entity, and then load the entity by label. This is useful because if someone try to go to a page, to a city, basically, that you don't have, the Drupal automatically manage this and return a 404 error page because it cannot upcast this parameter to anything. If we go to the service collector, the service page of the web profiler module, we can check that this weather city converter exists. It comes from the weather module. And it works. Drupal can find it because this service has been tagged with this param converter tag. So it's a parameter converter, and Drupal can use it to upcast parameter. Okay. You can also use Web Profiler to see database queries. So we saw here that, we saw here that Drupal performs a database query to load the city. And you can find it in the database collector where all the queries for a specific page are collected. And for every query, you can, for example, swap placeholder. So in the query on the top is the same as the query on the bottom with placeholder showed. The second one is exactly the query that Drupal executes on the database. You can copy the query and paste in some database client to check the result, for example. You can also run explain on the query to see if you can optimize it in some way. Okay. Turning back to the route definition, we saw the parameters section. The requirement section is quite easy because it just checks for the permission of the user. Then there are two defaults information. One is the dash controller, and the other is title callback. Let's start with the second one, the title callback. So you can have somewhere on your system a class called forecast controller that has a method that is called title. If you look at your code, somewhere you will find it. And this is where having a parameter converter is useful because the title method does not receive lil as a string, but it receives an object, an instance of the city entity, that I've defined. So you can, it's more type safety. You can be sure that you will receive a valid city in your code, and you can use it for example, build the title of the page, because city is a standard Drupal entity that automatically generates the label method, and you can use it to retrieve the label. Okay. The other information from the routing file is the controller that it used to build the page. We can see the code from that controller. It's more longer, but it received the same city entity that you can use, and then perform something to produce the response. Okay, the first thing that this controller does is to use some service, in this case this weather client service, to contact an external service. My service in Drupal is a PHP class, standard PHP class, that can be used to perform some useful task, for example, sending an email or authenticate user or call external service, like in this case. The core of Drupal has more than 500 services by itself, so there are a lot of functionalities that you can use that have already been defined in the core of Drupal. We already seen a couple of them before, because middlewares are services, and also param converters are services. In this case, we have a service that is called weather client, defined again in the weather module, that will contact, in this case, Open Weather Map, that will return us the forecast for the next days. Okay, so we can use again Web Profiler to see if the list of services that are defined, weather.weather underscore client is one of them. The class where the service is defined is the blue one, defined by the weather module, and so on. Again, if you click on the name of the class, you will be redirected to your ID directly to the page where to the file where the code is. Okay. Another useful information that we can grab using Web Profiler in this page is that Drupal performs an HTTP request to another service, to Open Weather Map, to collect weather information. So we can see the URL that has been contacted, the request headers that we send to the external system, some statistics about the request, some information about the response. We can use it to understand what it happens every time your Drupal contacts some external services. Okay, so we have our page built. Okay, so forecast controller is the file that builds the response. Not really, because forecast controller returns the title of the page and some array. It does not return HTML. It does not return all the markup of the page. It does not return the blocks around our information. It does not return CSS or JavaScript. Okay, so where all those information comes from? Basically, this is managed by the render pipeline of Drupal. What the controller returns is a render array, basically. A render array is just a multidimensional PHP array with some convention, because keys that start with sharp are properties of the render array. A keys that doesn't start with sharp are the nested render arrays, because you can build render arrays of render arrays. Okay. One important information that you must always declare on a render array, always, is the cache information, because this is used to tell Drupal how the output of this render array should be cached to be reused when it can be reused, and to be rebuilt when it has to be rebuilt. In our case, we set that the max age of the response is 3 hours, because we collect forecast information for the next 3 hours. We add some cache tag, and we say that the response of this controller must be different by URL. So every URL you have must have a different cache. Okay. We are using this stem hook that it's called weather underscore forecast. We can try to inspect Drupal to find the list of all available stem hooks that we can use. Yes. Or switch arguments. Yes. This is provided by the devel module, but you have it because Web Profiler requires it. The devel module provides you a list of all tem hooks that you can use in your controller when you return a response. In this case, we are using this weather underscore forecast that has been defined in our weather module. In here, you will find the variable that you can send to the template, the path of the template, and some other information. Okay. In our case, if you look at the weather module, in the weather.module file itself, you will find the definition of the weather underscore forecast tem hook that accepts these four variables: the forecast, the units, metrics or imperial, the description, and the coordinates that it used to build the page itself that finally is built by a Twig file. So at the end, Drupal will use, this maybe is too small, but at the end Drupal will use this Twig file to convert all the information you retrieve from OpenWeatherMap and from the database of Drupal in the final HTML. So here we are using information from the forecast, information from the description or the coordinates that are on the city entity. And at the end, your controller returns this render array with this theme information. But this is still not a response. This is still some array with some information from the render system of Drupal. The latest part is managed by a different system. That is the event system, because in Drupal, a lot of systems are loosely coupled, and the communication between these subsystems happens using the event system. Okay, so at some point, the Drupal kernel takes the response from the controller, that is a render array, and it dispatches a kernel.view event. How we discover that is this the event that has been dispatched? By tracing the page. So we have profiling the page until now. Now we try to trace it. To trace a page, we can use, for example, this module that is in very alpha stage, but it works. That is O11Y for observability. The observability module uses data collected by the tracer module that the web profiler downloaded also. And they use those information to send trace data to a software called OpenTelemetry. That is an open source system to collect telemetry information from a system. Then OpenTelemetry wrote all the information that it collects using another open source tool that is Grafana Tempo. And then we can use Grafana itself to build dashboards to analyze the information that we traced. And in this case, we discovered that at some point, just after Drupal build the controller, perform the HTTP call, Drupal calls the kernel.view event, okay. Web profiler has a page where all the events are collected, so you can use this to discover which class will respond to the kernel.view event. You can go there and you can see what Drupal does when the response returned by a controller is not a response by itself, but is an array, for example. And this is not the end, because there is another event just after the kernel.view, that is this one, that is render.page_display_variant_select. You can use WebProfiler again to see where this code is. And you can look at the code just to discover how Drupal adds all blocks around your content. So basically, in this event subscriber, this code that responds to the event, Drupal will load all the visible blocks per region and then add the information from the block system to the render array that your controller has returned. Okay, WebProfiler has a page that collects all blocks that are used on a page, both the blocks that are loaded but not rendered because some visibility rules, and all the blocks that are effectively rendered. So you can discover this information too. Okay, and at the end, index.php send the response to the browser, and it terminates the kernel. So in effect, it dispatches some other events when the kernel terminates, and then you can use those information to perform some cleanup or whatever. Okay. There are some other useful data collector that Web Profiler offers after the page is returned to the browser that you can use, for example, to inspect the rendering call graph of all Twigs files. In this case, we can see our weather -forecast.html.twig, the time that Drupal spend parsing and converting that file to HTML, and so on. This page is way longer than this one. You can also see the list of all Twig filters and Twig functions that are available on your system that you can use in your Twig files. Our template uses a couple of them, for example. And you can see assets collected for the page. There is the list of all CSS files or JavaScript files that has sended to a page. And in the latest version of Web Profiler, you also have the list of libraries that you have attached to the templates, for example. In this case, we have those two weather slash base and weather slash map libraries that are used to build to style the page, basically. And there are way more information that you can collect from Web Profiler. For example, you can list that the latest version of Web Profiler also collects and lists all the single directory components that we've used on your page. So if you try the latest Drupal with the Umami profile, where they already replaced some templates with SDC components, you can see in the toolbar of the Web Profiler those components. You can also extract Core Web Vitals information only if you are on Chrome, because it works basically only on Chrome. So you can see cumulative layout shift and other information useful for optimizing the front end. You can see all the AJAX calls that a page performs, for example, to download the toolbar. When you are logged in on Drupal, the toolbar of the contextual information are retrieved using AJAX. You can retrieve information about forms, about views, and then you can see if your page has been redirected from some other page or forwarded from some other page. You can see all the information from that request. And you can also see information collected by the request that Drupal does to the BigPipe module. If you know how BigPipe module works, it performs some sub request from the main request to retrieve all the difficult to cache part of the page that will be returned asynchronously. But if you want to have more information about the latest version of Web Profiler, there are two tech blog on the tech blog of Spark Fabric, so you can check there. And the latest thing, I wrote a book. So if you are interested in the front-end part of Drupal and what happens when Drupal builds a page, render the output, and so on, just for today, 20% off. So go buy the book. You also will find chapters about single directory components, about Next.js, so build the couple front end using Drupal, and integration with Storybook. So there are a lot of information. Okay, We are at the end. There are a lot of work, you know, in Drupal, so please come to contribution sprints and contribute whatever project you want. Web Profiler itself needs some of love, so if you have time or whatever, feel free to contact me. And thank you. I think we have some time for questions if you want. Otherwise, I'm here if you want to see a live demo of all of these. Why not? If you maybe.
This one? Okay.
This is the most important slide of the presentation. So. Can you talk with the, because otherwise in the online.
Hello, is it on?
Maybe.
Thank you very much. This seems like a silly question, but I'll ask it anyway. When you're running that, you're getting all the data back, yeah? But you've got the admin module running everything toolbar. So can you like strim it right down just so that it's, you're getting? Yeah.
So the question is if you can collect information about anonymous users, because in the presentation I'm always logged in the website. Of course, there is a permission to show the toolbar to roles, so you can show the toolbar also for anonymous user, but you don't have to. The toolbar is just a side effect of collecting information. So information are collected in any time for every page. Then the toolbar is loaded in AJAX after the page is returned. So you can navigate the website as anonymous user, and then on the reports section you will find also those information. And oops, for all profiled information, you can go to the profile, and then so all the collected information for every, okay, for every page. Exactly. Also, it is if it is a API call, because it works exactly the same way. You're welcome.
Hello. There used to be a timeline in display, but I could not find it. Is it replaced by something? The timeline display.
In the previous the question is where is the timeline that will be in the previous version, the Drupal 9 version. The Drupal 8 and 9 version has a timeline like the one from Symfony. That show all the same information that now you can find using using Grafana, for example. That is here. This is mainly because that version is built using D3.js in JavaScript, and I don't know how to use it. Well, the Drupal 10 version is completely different from the Drupal 9 version because the Symfony version is different. So the underlying code of Symfony has changed between Symfony 4 and Symfony 6. So I rebuild all the module, but I don't know how to rebuild the toolbar, the timeline. So if some of you is skilled on JavaScript and timeline in JavaScript. But now you can use, if you want, you can use the tracer module, send all the information to Tempo and Grafana, and then use Grafana that is way more cool than my version. Thank you again.